Take heed, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing wickedly from the living God. But exhort one another, yourselves, daily, every day, whilst it is called today, lest any of you, among you, be hardened through the seducing deceitfulness of sin. For we are made partakers of Christ, if so be we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast unto the end. In these three verses, there are three things in general proposed by the apostle. First, an exhortation unto the avoidance of an evil, even that which it is his principal design to caution them against, and to dissuade them from. Verse 12. Secondly, a proposal of one useful means in which they may be assisted in its avoidance. Verse 13. Thirdly, an enforcement of the exhortation from that evil, and unto the use of that means from a number of considerations as added in verse 14. In the first of these, we may consider what is included in it, namely, number one, the dependence of this exhortation on the discourse foregoing. Number two, the compilation used by the apostle in this renovation of an especial address to the Hebrews, brethren. Number three, the duty he exhorts them to, and that first is to the act of it, take heed, number two, as to the person's concern, lest there be in any of you. Number three, as to the object of it, or the evil to hoard it from, an evil heart of unbelief, which is further described by its effects in departing from the living God. Secondly, number one, the means of the prevention of the evil to hoard it from is presented, verse 13, and this in general is by exhortation against it, exhort, which has a treble qualification, first, as to the persons by whom it is to be performed, or the means used, one another. Secondly, the season of its performance, which also includes the manner of it, every day. Thirdly, with the limitation of that season, while it is called today. An especial enforcement of this preventative duty from the danger of their condition, which would be increased by a neglect of it. And this is described first from the cause of it, the deceitfulness of sin. Secondly, from its tendency and effects, lest any be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. Thirdly, there is a general enforcement of the whole, both as to the evil to be avoided and the means to be used for that purpose. And this is taken from their state and condition on supposition of the avoidance of the one and observance of the other. Verse 14. And this is expressed, for we are partakers of Christ, and declared as to his dependence on the preceding exhortation, if so be we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast to the end. In the exhortation proposed, in the first place, there is included, number one, a dependence on the discourse foregoing. Some suppose a hyperbaton in the words, and that this take heed depends immediately on the wherefore, which is in the beginning of verse 7, as was intimated on that place. So the following words are introduced only as an instance to enforce the exhortation by. In this sense, the reference here is to be taken immediately from the authority of Christ over his house, and the necessity of our perseverance to the securing of our interest in that house, is verses 5 and 6. Therefore, take heed, brethren. But the truth is, the manner of this exhortation is deduced so directly and immediately out of the foregoing example, that we must in it own a respect thereunto. For the words are a plain inference from that discourse, though the note of elation be omitted, as if the apostle had said, seeing it is this way, seeing our forefathers who were our types and are proposed for an example to us, did so miscarry under a dispensation of God representing that which he exercises now towards us, let us take heed. This is the dependence of the words. The apostle, returning to the Hebrews with a special address and exhortation, renews his former affectionate compilation, brethren. This has been spoken unto in verse 1 of this chapter, where the reader may find the reason of it and what is contained in it. Only the cause wherefore he repeats it again seems to be that it might appear that he had no commotion of spirit upon him in his pressing the severe instance and example insisted on. A minister must be, 1 Timothy 3:3, meek, patient, and not easily provoked, Titus 1, verse 7, not soon angry with his flock or any of them. And tenderness, gentleness, demonstrations of love and care towards them with whom we have to do, secretly soften them and open their ears and hearts to let in a word of instruction and exhortation. Besides, he obviates any suspicion that might arise as though he insinuated a fear of such an evil in them, and might make them think that he had hard thoughts of them. By this appellation he removes all such jealousies, and lets them know that the best of saints had need be cautioned sometimes against the worst of evils. The manner of the performance of their duty, thirdly exhorted to. The act of it is expressed in the first word, take heed, is firstly and properly to see and behold, as that is an act of sense, then to take heed or beware, an act of the mind, by an easy translation, first video, then caveo. And when it is used for to see as an act of sense, it commonly has respect to expectation, either of some good to be received or of some inconvenience to be watched against. And because men look out or about them to beware of dangers, the word is used for to take heed or beware. In this sense, it is often used in the New Testament, yea, so far as I have observed, in a peculiar unto the sacred writers, especially it is frequently used by our apostle in 1 Corinthians 1 verse 26, 10 verse 18, Philippians 3 2, Ephesians 5 15, and Colossians 2 8. And sometimes it is used transitively, affecting the object, merely for to consider, 1 Corinthians 1 26, consider your calling, chapter 10 18, consider Israel according to the flesh. Sometimes it has a reciprocal pronoun joined with it. 2 John 8, consider or look well to yourselves. Sometimes it is used absolutely as here, and signifies to beware of somewhat. But in this sense it has often joined with it in Mark 8, 15, which in Matthew 16, 6 is take heed of or beware of the leaven of the Pharisees. Observation number 1. There is need of great care, heedfulness, watchfulness, and circumspection for a due continuance in our profession to the glory of God and advantage of our own souls. A careless profession will issue in apostasy, open or secret, or great distress. Matthew 13, 5 and 6. Our course is a warfare, and those who do not take heed, who are not circumspect in war, will assuredly be a prey to their enemies. Be their strengths never so great, sometime or another they will not avoid a fatal surprise. And there is a necessity of this heedful attendance in us. For in the manifold duties that in all things and at all times are incumbent on us, our whole life is a life of duty and obedience. God is in everything to be regarded by us. So that we are to be attentive to our duty on all occasions, Psalm 16:8, Genesis 17:1. If we fail in matter or manner, what lies in us will spoil the whole. Any one defect is enough to denominate an action evil, but to that which is good there must be a concurrence of all necessary circumstances, Ephesians 5:15 and 16. And who is sufficient for these things? God alone by His Spirit and grace can enable us to this. But He works these things by us as well as in us, and gives heedful diligence where He gives success. But it is with special reference to difficulties, oppositions, dangers, temptations, that this caution is here given us to be cautious. And who can reckon up the number or dispose into order these things, and that whether we consider those that constantly attend us or those that are occasional, among opposition, snares, and dangers that we are constantly exposed to, and which without heedfulness we cannot avoid, the apostle here instances in one, namely that of an evil heart of unbelief, which must be spoken to. And he gives an instance in those that are occasional, Ephesians 5, verses 15 and 16. Walk circumspectly, because the days are evil. There is a special evil in the days in which we live, which we cannot avoid without great circumspection. Now, this taking heed consists, number one, in a due consideration of our danger. He that walks in the midst of snares and serpents and goes on confidently without consideration of his danger, as if his paths were all smooth and safe, will one time or other be entangled or bitten. Blind confidence in the course of profession, as if the whole of it were a dangerless road, is a ruining principle. 1 Peter 1:17, Proverbs 28:14. A prudent man foresees the evil and hides himself, but the simple pass on and are punished. Proverbs 22:3. It is the highest folly not to look out after dangers, and which usually ends in sorrow, trouble, and punishment. Fear is necessary in continual exercise. Not a fear of distrust or diffidence, of anxious scrupulosity, but of care, duty, and diligence. Continually to fear dangers in all things brings a useless, perplexing scrupulosity, where men's principle of duty is only a harassed, convinced conscience, and the rule of it is the doctrines and traditions of men. But where the principle of it is the spirit of grace, with all this fear there is liberty. And where the rule of it is the word, there is safety, peace, and stability. Men at sea that are in the midst of rocks and shells and consider it not will hardly avoid a shipwreck. Livy tells us of Philippa men, that wary Grecian commander. Wherever he went, though he were all alone, he was still considering all places that he passed by, how an enemy might possess them and lay ambushes in them to his disadvantage, if he should command an army in those places. By this he became the most wary and expert captain of his age. So should a Christian do, he should always consider how, where, by what means, his spiritual adversaries may ensnare or engage him, and so either avoid them or oppose them, and not be like the simple, pass on heedlessly and be punished. Ephesians 6:11-12, and so on. Number two. In a due consideration of the special nature of those snares and dangers that we are exposed to, it is not enough that in general we know and reckon on it that we are obnoxious to dangers, but we must learn what are the special dangers as things are circumstanced in our lives, callings, ways, times, and seasons that are apt easily to beset us. To know and continually ponder their nature and advantages, this is wisdom, the greatest wisdom we can exercise in the whole course of our walking and profession. 1 Peter 5:8. He that takes heed in this will not likely fail in other instances. But here custom, security, false pleasing, confidence of our own strength, negligence and sloth, all put in to delude us. And if we are here imposed on, that we weigh not aright the nature and efficacy of our own peculiar snares and temptations, we shall assuredly at one time or another fail and miscarry in the course of our obedience. This was David's wisdom when he kept himself from his own iniquity. Psalm 18:23. God would have us cast all our care about earthly things on him, but be watchful ourselves through his grace about spiritual, but we are apt to fail on both hands. Number three. It is so to heed them as to endeavor to avoid them, and that in all their occasions, causes, and advantages, in their whole work and efficacy. We are not only to consider them when they assault us, but to watch against all ways in which they may so do. This is the duty of a man that stands armed on his guard. He is very regardless of his enemy, who never seeks to avoid him, but when he sees him or feels him. Men will consider the lion's walk so as not without good means of defense to be found in it. The lion is in all the special oppositions we are exercised with. We had need continually to be fenced with iron and the staff of a spear, as 2 Samuel 23:7. And yet to avoid them what we are able. God expresses his great dislike of them that walk contrary to him, as we have rendered the words in Leviticus 26:21. If you walk with me at a peradventure, or at all adventures, carelessly, negligently, without due consideration of your duty and your danger, this God will not bear. Number 4. Consider them so as to oppose them. And this consists in these things, first, in being always ready, armed, and standing on your guard, Ephesians 6:13, Mark 13:37, 2 Samuel 23:7. Secondly, in calling in help and assistance, Hebrews 2:18, Hebrews 4:16. Thirdly, in improving the supplies granted us with faith and diligence, Hebrews 12, verse 1. And these are some of the things that belong to this duty. And they are but some of them, for it is diffused through the whole course of our profession and is indispensably required of us if we would abide in the beauty and glory of it to the end. And therefore the negligence and sloth of many professors can never enough be bewailed. They walk at all adventure as if there were no devil to tempt them, no world to seduce them, ensnare them, or oppose them, no treachery in their own hearts to deceive them. And hence it is that many are sick, and many are weak, and some are fallen asleep in sin. But what our Savior said of all of old, he says still to us all, watch. Mark 13:37. Number 2. There are the persons concerned in this duty, lest there be in any of you. It's somewhat more emphatical than the last, in which alone we render it. Some translations say, lest perchance, with respect unto a dubious event. Others, lest there be at any time, or less so, there should be. The apostle does not seem in these words strictly to intend every individual person, as if he had said, let every one of you look to himself in his own heart, lest it be so with him. But he speaks to them collectively to take care that there be none such amongst them, that none be found amongst them with such a heart as he cautions them against. And this consequently falls on every individual, for where all are spoken to, everyone is concerned. The same kind of expression is used to the same purpose in chapter 12, 15 and 16. Watching, overseeing, mutually, with diligence, lest any among you fail of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness springing up trouble you, and thereby many be defiled. Lest there be any fornicator or profane person as Esau. Here the caution is evidently given to the whole church, and the duty of the whole is expressed thereon. So is it likewise in this place, as appears from the direction that he gives for the right performance of this duty, ended by mutual watchfulness and exhortation in the next verse. This then is proposed to the whole church, to the whole society, and consequentially to every member thereof, so that we may hence observe, number 2, godly jealousy concerning and watchfulness over the whole body, that no beginnings of backsliding from Christ and the gospel be found amongst him, is the duty of all churches of believers. He that first put in an exception to this rule was the first apostate from God, who did it to cover a former sin. Says Cain, Genesis 4:9, am I my brother's keeper? Is it my duty to look after him, to take care of him, or what becomes of him? God proposed a question so to him as it was apt in its own nature to lead him to confession and repentance. But he was now hardened in sin, and having quarreled with God and slain his brother, he now casts off all the remaining dictates of the law of nature, accounting that one brother is not bound to take care of the welfare of another. Mutual watchfulness over one another by persons in any society is the prime dictate of the law of our creation, which was first rejected by this first murderer, and every neglect of it has something of a murder in it, 1 John 3:11, 12, and 15. In a church relation, the obligation to this duty is ratified by institution. Upon the officers of the church, it is incumbent by the way of office, on all believers as members of the church in a way of love, Leviticus 19:17. Thou shalt not hate thy brother in thine heart. Thou shalt not in any wise rebuke thy neighbor and not suffer sin upon him. He that does not watch over his brother to prevent his sin or recover him from it, as much as lies in him, he hates him and is so far a murderer. And the necessity of this duty is expressed in the word used to declare it in a manner of its usage. Rebuking thou shalt rebuke him, that is, plainly and effectually, and that with such rebukes as consist in arguings, reasonings, and pleadings, to bring on a conviction. So the word signifies, and is used as to the pleadings or reasonings of men with God to prevail with him. Job 13:3. Surely I would speak to the Almighty. I desire to reason, argue, plead with God until I can prevail with him. And it is used of God's pleading with men to bring them to conviction. Isaiah 1:18. Go to, or come now, and let us plead together. So that an effectual dealing with a brother about sin is included, and this is enforced in the latter clause of the words, which may well be rendered, and you shall not bear iniquity for him, that is, make yourself guilty of his sin by not reproving him. And for that jealousy which is to accompany this watchfulness, and the effects of it, our apostle gives an example in himself, 2 Corinthians 11:2-3. I am jealous over you with a godly jealousy, for I fear, lest by any means, your mind should be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ. This belongs to their watch, as they watch for the souls of their people, as they who must give an account, Hebrews 13:17. The discharge of this duty will be required of them on the account of their office, and that when, I fear, some will be hard put to it for an answer. For the Bible is full of threatenings and denunciations of sore judgments against those that shall be found negligent herein. But does this excuse other believers, members of churches, from a share and interest in this duty? No, doubtless, unless it renders them Cains, that is, transgressors against the light of nature, and who, as to the institutions of Christ, manifest themselves not to be members of the same mystical body with them that really believe. For in the observation of this and the like duties of their common interest, does the preservation of that body consist? Christ is the head, from whom the whole body fitly joined together and compacted by that which every joint supplies, according to the effectual working in the measure of every part, makes increase of the body to the edifying of itself in love, Ephesians 4:16. Every joint, every part in this mystical body that receives influences of life from Christ, the head, and so holds of him, is to work effectually and to give out the supplies which it receives from Christ to the preservation, increase, and edification of the whole. There is indeed a causeless suspicion that some are apt to indulge to, instead of this watchful jealousy. But this is a bane of churches and of love, as that is the preservation of them both. The apostle places evil surmises or suspicions among the works of men of corrupt minds, 1 Timothy 6:4, and that deservedly. But this godly watchful jealousy is that which he commends to others in the example of himself. And whatever appearance they may have, one of the other, they may be easily distinguished. Jealousy is a solicitous care proceeding from love, suspicion a vain conjecturing proceeding from curiosity, vanity, or envy. He that has the former, his heart is ruled by love towards him concerning whom he has it. From this he is afraid, lest they should miscarry, lest any evil should befall them. For love is the willing of all good to others, that they may prosper universally. Suspicion is an effect of curiosity and vanity of mind, whence commonly there is somewhat of envy and secret self-pleasing in the miscarriages of others mixed with it, a fault too often found amongst professors. And this vice puts forth itself in vain babbling and unheedful defamations, in which the other works by love, tenderness, prayer. Mutual exhortation is in the next verse. Observation 3. It is the duty of every individual believer to be intent on all occasions, lest at any time or by any means there should be found in him an evil heart of unbelief. This, as was showed, follows on the former, and is a necessary consequence of it. But this so directly falls in with what will be offered from the next clause that thereunto we refer it. The evil thus earnestly cautioned against is expressed and the principle of it, and that is the work or effect of that principle in these words. The principle of the evil is an evil heart of unbelief. What is meant by the heart, in the sense in which it is here used, was declared on the verses preceding. What is meant by evil shall be showed in its proper place. In special, it is said to be an evil heart of unbelief, that is, say most, an evil heart, an incredulous or unbelieving, an evil and unbelieving heart. So the genitive case of the substantive is put forth for the adjective by a Hebraism not unusual. In this sense, unbelieving is either exegetical, declaring what is meant by the evil heart in this place, even an unbelieving heart, or it is additious, and so a heart is signified which in general is evil and in particular unbelieving. A heart of unbelief, that is, under the power of unbelief, principled by unbelief in its actings. What this unbelief is and how the heart is rendered evil by it, we must now inquire. As for unbelief, it is usually distinguished into that which is negative and that which is privative. First, negative unbelief is whenever any man or men believe not or have not faith, although they never had the means of believing granted to them. For when men believe not, they are unbelievers, whether they have had any means of believing or not, or whether their unbelief be culpable or not, whatever may be the nature or degree of its demerit. So the apostle calls him an unbeliever who comes in accidentally to the assembly of the church, who never heard the word preached before. In this sense, all those persons and nations who have never had as yet the gospel preached to them are infidels or unbelievers. That is, they are so negatively. They believe not, but yet cannot be said to have in them an evil heart of unbelief. Secondly, it is privative. When men believe not, although they enjoy the means of faith or believing. And herein consists the highest acting of the depraved nature of man. And it is on many accounts the greatest provocation of God that a creature can make himself guilty of. For it is, as might be manifested, in opposition to God in all the properties of his nature, and in the whole revelation of his will. Hence the gospel, which is a declaration of grace, mercy, and pardon, though it condemns all sin, yet it denounces the final condemnation of persons only against this sin. He that believeth shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. Mark 16:16. Now this privative unbelief is twofold. First, in refusing to believe when it is required. Secondly, in rejecting the faith after it has been received. The first is when the object of faith, or that which is to be believed, is according to the mind of God, and in the way of his appointment proposed to men, when sufficient evidence is given to the truth and goodness of what is so proposed, and when the authority is made known on which faith is required, yet they refuse to believe. For the three things, a revelation of the things to be believed, made known in the way of God, sufficient evidence given to the truth proposed, and a just assertion of the authority of God requiring faith and obedience, render the unbelief of men privative. Now as this has its root in the natural darkness, blindness, and depravedness of the minds of men, so it is educed and acted not without new sinful prejudices and stubbornness of the will, refusing to attend to and consider the evidences that are given to the truth proposed, or the goodness and excellency of the things themselves contained in the propositions of truth, nor without signal effects of hardness of heart, love of sin and pleasure, keeping men off from the obedience required. Some instances may clear these particulars. First, the root of this unbelief is in the original deprivation of our natures, with the spiritual impotency and enmity to God in which it consists. There is such an impotency in us by nature that no man of himself by his own strength can believe, can come to Christ. Some self informs us in John 6:44, no man, saith he, can come to me except the Father draw him. That is, none can believe unless they are in a special manner taught of God, as he explains himself in verse 45. Again, by nature that carnal mind is in all men which is enmity against God, which is not subject to his law, neither indeed can be, Romans 8:7. Hereunto may be referred all that is spoken about the death of men in sin, their blindness and distrust, their alienation from God and obstinacy therein. This is a root and remote cause of all unbelief. Men in the state of nature neither can nor will believe the gospel. But secondly, besides this general cause of unbelief, when it comes to particular instances, and a gospel is proposed to this or that man for his assent and submission to it, there is always some special corruption of mind or will, voluntarily acted, if the soul be kept off from believing, and on the account of it principally and not merely of original impotency and enmity against God, is a guilt of unbelief reflected upon the souls of the sinners. There is the same fundamental remote cause of unbelief in all that refuse the gospel, but the next immediate proper cause of it is peculiar to every individual unbeliever. First, some are kept off from believing the gospel by inveterate prejudices in their minds, which they have taken in upon corrupt principles and interests. This is what kept most of the Jews under their unbelief. They had received many prejudices against the person of Christ, which on all occasions they expressed, and so were offended at him and believed not. That he was poor, that he came out of Galilee, that the rulers and teachers of the church rejected him, were their pleas against him. So also they had against his doctrine, and that principally on two false principles, one of justification by the works of the law, as our apostle directly declares, Romans 9:31-32, and 10:3, the other of the perpetuity or unchangeableness of the institutions of Moses, with which the apostle deals in this epistle. And these prejudices arose partly from their pride in seeking after righteousness by the works of the law, and partly from a corrupt desire of earthly things, riches, dominion, and wealth, which they expected with and by their Messiah, whereof I have treated elsewhere at large. These were in many the immediate causes of their unbelief, as is everywhere manifest in the gospel, and so is it with many at all times. Prejudices against the preachers of the gospel, on a number of accounts, and against their doctrine, is either useless or false or unintelligible, or somewhat they know not what, which they do not like, keep them off from attending to the word and believing. See John 5:44. Secondly, a special obstinacy of will from those prejudices offers itself in this manner. So our Savior tells the Pharisees in John 5:40, "You will not come to me that you might have life." It is not the perverseness and obstinacy that is in the wills of all men by nature that our Savior here intends, but a special perverseness in them arising out of a special envy to the hatred of him and his doctrine. So they did not only not receive him, which might be charged on their natural impotency, but they put forth a positive act of their wills in refusing and rejecting him. And on this account, the guilt of men's unbelief is absolutely resolved into their own wills. And whether it be discovered or not, this is a condition with many in all times and seasons. Thirdly, love of sin is, with some, the immediate cause of their actual unbelief, John 3:19. This is a condemnation that light has come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light because their deeds were evil. The light of the gospel is brought to a place or people. They come so near it as to discover its end and tendency, but so soon as they find that it aims to part them in their sins, they will have no more to do with it. And on this account, this condemnation follow the preaching of the gospel, though its own proper end be salvation and that only. And this is a common way of the ruin of souls. They don't like the terms of the gospel because of their love of sin, and so perish in and for their iniquities. Fourthly, stupid ignorance arising from the possessing of the minds of men with other things, inconsistent with the faith and obedience of the gospel, through the craft and subtlety of Satan, is another cause of it. So our apostle tells us in 2 Corinthians 4:4, that the God of this world has blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. It is when the minds of men are beamed into with the light of the gospel that they believe, for by that light is faith produced. How is this hindered? How is it obstructed? It is by the darkness and blindness of their minds. What darkness is this? That which is natural and common to all? No, but that which is in a peculiar manner brought and reflected on the minds of some men by the craft and deceits of the god of this world. That is, through his temptations and suggestions, he so fills and possesses their minds with the things of this world, whence he is here peculiarly called the god of this world, that they are kept in a stupid and brutish ignorance of spiritual things, and this keeps them off from believing. These are a few of the many instances that might be given of the immediate causes of their primitive unbelief, which consists in the rejecting or not receiving the truths of the gospel, when they are proposed in a due manner to the minds of men. And this fully clears the holiness and righteousness of God in his judgments against final and impenitent unbelievers to whom the gospel is preached. For as that impotency which is in them naturally is culpable, and it is no excuse for them for not believing because of themselves they could not so do, seeing it is by their own default that they are brought into that condition, so every one in his own person who believes not does, by a voluntary act of his will, reject the gospel, and that on such corrupt principles as none can deny to be his sin.